Hello, friends. Thanks for spending time with us. I'm here with Jen Perret. How are you?
I'm good.
What do you do with the company?
What do I do? Well, so right now, I am the GPM for our cloud testing space in the developer division. So I care all about testing.
All right, and we're going to talk about all things testing, and we're going to cover a bunch of different things. Specifically, we're going to talk about automated testing, both with Azure and with Playwright. This is us and the things we care about.
I tried to get a good taco image, but then I was worried about licensing. It's, so, you know,
between
icons.
Between that and diet soda, really, you couldn't have gone in a better
anywhere,
direction.
Right? Good. Awesome. So let's get out of slides. Oh.
Is there one more slide?
No, I think that's it.
Okay.
All right. We said no slides, right?
Yeah. No demo.
All right. There it is. So bring that down.
I love that you brought up PowerPoint to just show pictures of us.
I know.
And then now we're
how
out of PowerPoint
is that?
For the rest.
Okay. So this is us. You saw us. He likes tacos. I like all things Azure and all things testing. So Scott, here's the thing.
Hmm?
We're here to talk about automated testing. You run this incredibly popular Hanselman Minutes. I don't know. Is it popular?
My podcast? No.
I think it's pretty popular.
Yeah.
But you know what?
A dozen people that watch it.
You don't have any testing on it.
Yeah, so I made the mistake of giving Jen access to some source code. And we've got this .NET podcast application that you can go up on GitHub and get. And it sucks in podcasts, one of which is mine. And we said, hey, this is great sample code. It's cloud native, and it's this, and it's containers, and Kubernetes, and cyber noodles. And
then, cyber
and
noodles,
the, and
exactly.
Then Jen's like, but where are the unit tests?
Where's which the is, basic end-to-end correctness tests?
I have to.
Okay, sorry.
It's, yeah, she twists,
I took that knife.
Twist the knife, yeah. Yeah.
Having fun.
Even a test, just one test. So then you wrote tests.
So actually my team, so I have big shout out, you all know who you are. My team actually put together some Playwright tests, which is what we're going to talk about first. Those Playwright tests are now actually up in the main .NET podcast. So anybody, we have about 500 forks of that code.
Yep.
So anyone who has that, just sync, get those tests for free. And we're going to go into Playwright first and foremost. So we were asked by the MVPs, I love this guy. It's like, just show us a basic test. Show us hello world. So the first thing that I'm going to do to intro Playwright. Has anyone heard of Playwright? We don't really have a poll on online.
We got Playwright.
But
anyone
we got
heard
some
of
Playwright.
Okay. Selenium or Cypress?
Yeah.
Or, okay.
Okay. So Playwright is an open source library. It was actually launched in 2020. It is actually a fully open source, cross-browser, cross-language. And it has a full API really designated for developers who can write in any language. So you've got your TypeScript, JavaScript, Python, C# and Java all available for you with Playwright. Now let's get in and show some goodness about Playwright. In particular, Playwright runs through a WebSocket interaction between both the browser and the actual test script. So it allows us to do some really, really cool things.
Yeah,
let's
while
do
she's
our
doing
hello
that,
world.
While she's doing that, there's something really interesting. So I've been doing Selenium testing and testing like that, browser automated testing since 2006, 2007. And there's a thing called the Web Driver Protocol that is a way to basically put your browser on puppet strings. And Selenium does that, except it doesn't do it with the Web Driver Protocol. It uses the DevTools protocol. So it's like when you hit F12, we can automate that. So we can ask questions and we can test stuff. And it's so cool to see a test where you can like raise your hands and say, look, the buttons are getting clicked and
here
it's
we go.
Happening.
So
are you running tests?
I just did. So one of the best ways to use Playwright is the VS Code extension. Super easy, the command palette, just type install Playwright and you'll get this extension. Boom, no hands, okay. Test is running. This is really simple. Hey, did I subscribe to a channel? When the user subscribed to the channel, did that subscription happen? Now, within that test, what's great with VS Code, because we've got all of these interactions available, first and foremost, a lot of times with web testing, you get a lot of flaky tests because of that network interaction. Well, how fast is it going to get back? Is the page ready? And then you're going through and you're saying, hey, my test's failed. But, oh, well, that's just because it went too slow or, oh, something stalled out. With Playwright, what's beautiful is it's got this await API. So it actually talks from the test script to the browser, waits for that response to come back and then proceeds with the test. So you don't get those flaky tests that you get with a lot of other situations.
Yeah, and these are really comfortable looking things. Like, you may not know Playwright, but I hope you're looking at this and you're looking, for example, at line 11, where she just put a breakpoint. You can see, okay, I get that we're going to go and look for the first thing that has a class, a vitamin primary action, the first one there, and then we're going to click on it. So you're expressing user intent. You saw the browser pop up and started getting clicked on. The amount of confidence that it can give you in your own code is unbelievable. And I really want to juxtapose this from, you know, unit testing, integration testing, but like being able to go clicky, clicky, clicky makes you not afraid of your code anymore. Like, really. Okay, so you put a breakpoint on a test, so you're debugging a test.
Yes. So right now, I've now taken that same test where I did the look ma no hands, and I've actually got the debugger running in VS Code extensions. I can now step through. I can do the classic F10, keep stepping through.
I get focused on the left.
Oh yeah, I always do this. I go over there. Okay, so now I'm stepping through the test, and I can actually debug, and I can see what it's looking for. So all your different debugging requirements you need as you're setting your test. Good to go.
Let's pause for just a second. I want to point out how cool that is. Notice under the word subscriptions right there, see the locator. So Playwright is actually injecting additional context. So on the right-hand side, you can see what the intent was. So the test gets expressed by a little tooltip that got injected into your HTML there. And we can see exactly what's going on. So that side-by-side experience is really, really positive.
And I'm so glad you pointed that out so I didn't blast past it, because one of the most important things for Playwright and all of your web tests is, you know, you make a change in the DOM, you make any kind of edits just to the look and feel of the site, you don't want to have to go back and rewrite all your tests. So up on playwright.dev, you can go to the docs, best practices, talks all about the locators and how to use locators so that then if how that position gets on the page gets modified just from design, you're not rewriting tests. So you want tests to be able to be written quick. You also don't want to have maintenance where you have to keep rewriting them.
Yeah. I also want to point out that sometimes people say, well, you know, you should be writing tests. You should be writing tests all the time. You should be writing more tests than you write code. It's no fun to say write tests, but it is fun to automate stuff.
Oh.
So the way that I got through the, I don't want to write tests. Tests is no fun. I want to automate stuff because I would always control F5. I'd run my website. I'd click on five or six things and I go, that looks cool. And then I did it again. And I did it again. And I'm not realizing that I'm never getting those keystrokes back.
Yeah.
But you've heard me talk about this. I have a finite number of keystrokes left in my hands before I die. And if every time I'm running my thing, it's click, 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 there's five keystrokes. I'm not getting it back. But with Playwright, I'm automating that smoke test. And then I went from 1 to 20. And now I've got like 25 or 30 tests on my site.
Immediately.
And the sense of confidence that I have, though, of like, okay, I didn't break anything. And if I don't feel confident, I add more tests. Oop. Until I can sleep at night.
All right, that's so let me just do a little sizing. All this magic of sizing.
Yeah, getting it to work in a small screen is hard.
It's all those things. So I took my own build as we're trying to break some things, and of course I care about testing, so I called mine the Test Podcast.
Okay.
And then I go over here, and what I've done. Right as Scott was talking, as I went over, I got to move something.
I don't think you can move that.
Oh, I got to make it bigger.
That's okay. What she's done there is there's a button there you can't see that says record new. So you can write tests, which is kind of fun, but you can record tests,
them.
Which is super
way
fun.
Way better.
Right?
Okay.
Especially if you're not billing by the hour. Right? Go by the test.
Okay, so here's another look, ma, no hands. My mouse is over here. I'm selecting different things I want to go. And if you look over to the left, of course, it's being recorded. I can scroll down. I can decide, oh, you know, let's go to the discover. Do I get to the sign in? Yes, I do. Right? All of that has now come over here and been a test. So now I can make this bigger. And all of that was written out for me. Now, of course, like with any of these recording tests, you then do need to refactor. Right? You're not going to want things like hard-coded URLs. You're going to want to go through not only fixing that, but you can also do things because now it's right in TypeScript. You can come in and add all sorts of different expects and assertions that you would want. Now, when you record, it generally will do things like to have URL, right? Because it's kind of pulling, it can't read your mind. But what's great is now it's in IntelliSense. Oops, I did an extra. And you've got all these different things that you can then choose from.
Be falsy.
I know. I have not played with that one, but I've got
false,
to.
But it's falsy.
It's falsy. I'm going to do that tonight.
Yeah. But one of the things I want to point out, though, is that when we think about automation and recording tests, traditionally, and I didn't even write this, I wrote a thing called web automation testing in Ruby. I wrote in 2007, where I would look at the browser DOM and I try to write out these scripts. I want to point out that it actually wrote some boilerplate expectations. So each of those go-tos, if you may click away there and look at like lines.
To be truthy. That's
yeah,
another
to
one.
Be truthy. But okay. We have, you know, get by role or page.locator, and then it put in an expect. Now, it expects that it says discover more. Mm-hmm. I can decide. I can change. I can refactor. Yeah. Maybe it's not in English. Maybe I want it to work on any language.
Oh, it gets even better. So with Playwright, you can emulate. So not only can you have the English, but you can actually take your test, then set your emulator to different geolocations, different languages, right? Because who wants to have to go through all of that?
Yep.
You want to be able to say, hey, here's my environment for my testing. I want to hit not just all of these different browsers, but I also want to check all the geolocations.
Right, as well as I noticed that you changed because we have a small screen, your viewport. So I can say this is a smaller screen. We can have different browser drivers. So we can say it's Chrome, it's Edge, it's Firefox, it's whatever.
So here's this viewport. This is because I'm trying to learn how to do this 1080 stuff. I'm used to that wide screen. I've been working from home. So now one of the things to make sure that this would work, you can also emulate the viewport and decide what side. Now, again, all of this is when you want it in headed mode. When you're actually running these tests, guess what? Here's the surprise for you, Scott. Not only did I give you the tests, all the folks who have the .NET podcast, but these tests are also running every single pull request in the GitHub action.
Okay, now you said a funny word there. I want to call that out.
Funny word.
You said headed, the opposite of headless.
Yeah.
Have a head, headed. We just made that up. So
sorry.
Headless, headless test. Look at this button right here that says show browser, right? So she clicked show browser and the browser popped up. And I like that because it builds my confidence. I'm like, oh, look, it's clicking. And once you've got the, okay, I get it. You uncheck that button. All this stuff happens headless, which means I can run it, what, in a container? I can run it anywhere.
Yeah, and in fact, in the any GitHub action, any pipelines action, and with Playwright, because it runs in a container, any pipeline that actually enables containerized jobs, you can run Playwright. So your Jenkins, your CircleCI, your GitLab, Bitbucket, pipelines,
anywhere,
of them are available.
Anywhere the containers are sold.
Okay, so where do we want to go now? We've done this.
Well, I noticed, though, that you got to the point where you saw a login and then you conveniently just shut it down. Because, you know,
when you test,
a lot of people are like, well, yeah, you just tested some hello world, but you didn't actually log in.
Was there really smoke and mirrors there? Okay, so by requests, too, let me just shrink this down. One of the great things with Playwright, as we all know, we're trying to get developer productivity everywhere possible. When your tests take hours to run, you know, that's where we have those fun shirts around, oh, no, I'm not slacking, I'm just building, you know, right? We need that time shorter. It's super hard. You want to be able to test locally. You want to be able to run your tests. And you want it to be able to run fast. So what's beautiful with Playwright is you can sign in once, and then you can actually cache and save that sign-in. So for every other page you got to sign in, it just pulls from the cache. Now, in particular, super important, a lot of times in demos we don't show this, is when a website's got AAD auth on it. So what we did on the test podcast, we did not do this to the .NET podcast, we actually put in on the sign-in, we actually put AAD auth. And so
Azure
then...
Azure Active Directory,
yes.
AAD.
Oh, thank you. Thank
Sorry.
You.
If you have a TLA, I have to expand it. Three-letter acronym.
So good, yeah.
Okay.
So, and then we actually put in environment variables. So for the GitHub actions, we are actually running these tests with the Azure Active Directory logins in place.
Cool.
And then what it's doing is it's pulling right here. So you go into the global setup. So let's go into, let me show the Explorer a little bit better. So in Playwright, what we've done is we've actually added the tests under the web-specific directory called end-to-end. And then we have a global setup. This global setup is where you can set up all the sort of configurations specific for how you want those tests to run. And within that, then you can actually say, hey, there's going to be a spot where you're going to have to go sign in. grab it from your either GitHub secret, or if you're running locally in your environment variables that you've set locally, then grab the password, enter it, and then this is where things get exciting. Then save it in this local or wherever the process is running within that container, this storage state. And then for every other login, we will just use that so that you can zip on past.
Cool. Does it actually work? Can you run it?
It does actually work. So I actually can run, I mean, any of those tests. Let's see. What? Now we're going to wing it. Let's go out into some of the tests. Discover is where we actually had the login. I think I got the environment variables right. So let's go see if we can run it. And I have not logged in yet.
We'll find out. If the point is it's a live demo.
Yeah. And then if not, we'll also, one of the things I did also do is I kicked off the GitHub CI/CD test.
Yeah, let's go into
and
there
local.
Next.
So we'll go there next.
So while these are running, you can see some of them have run and some of them are thinking about running, and we're going to see some automation.
Oh, and we will see one failure.
Oh, good. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Because I want to see things break, because if it only works, then it's not a real demo.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that's worth pointing out, and this blew my mind, is that Playwright can record videos and screenshots of what's happening so that you can go back later and see what happened. And then they can even do diffs, visual diffs, to say, well, we broke some CSS because this thing moved over here. And it'll tell you, this page is 20% different than that other page. These pages are different. So it's actually going to compare the screenshots and give you a comparison, which is crazy. All right, is it still testing?
It's still running. So if you notice.
Ooh, what's this?
Check it out. Remember I told you I shrunk down that viewport? Well, the comparison is no longer, therefore, running or getting the same view, because now I've shrunk down the actual viewport in the local test. So let me go ahead and stop these tests for a second. Let's see if I can stop these tests. There it is.
I expected an image of this size, and I got one at this size.
And what?
What a great actual error that is has information, and I can do something about it.
And you know what I did? I did actually save this over here. So I have the same screenshot. So
oh, yeah?
I'll show you. So you're not watching me fumble around here. This is the exact same challenge where it's actually saying, hey, wait, we expected. Wait, is this the same error? Let's see.
It's like a video of the thing here.
Oh, yeah.
Test
All
results.
Right. Here it is. Screenshot comparison. So I did save it. And in this one, you can actually, this is what the report will look like. So you can end up, after you run your test, you'll get this report. You'll see the error. Now things get really fun. You start going down into the steps, and you can say, oh, this is actually looking for a visual regression. So it's doing a visual regression test, and it has the actual, this case, we actually removed a screen, the expected, and then the diff. So you'll get all of that, but you'll also get things like, oh, wow, here's the screenshots, the traces, and the videos.
I do want to call out that we worked really, really hard to put together an end-to-end complete cloud demo, and I want to give a shout out to the gentleman in the third row who started to try to get a room clapping.
Oh.
And then he kind of like.
And I was down in the screen.
Are
so.
They going? Are we going for it? Are we doing this? And it's like, that's how we. Oh my God, that was amazing. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, this stuff is so powerful because they can do this right now. This isn't preview. We can
this
do this
is
stuff
none
right
of this
now.
Is preview. This is yes. All available. So let's go see. We started this. Let me see if we've got a lot of things going on here. I didn't
well, we changed the viewport, so we're going to get all those things to fail, but that's okay.
Okay, so then we're going to go here. The other thing I'm going to do really quick, so I'm in, that's what's going on. So right here, I've actually run the test previously. So before I came up here, I actually ran through a bunch of our tests, expecting
oh, wow.
a bunch of errors.
Okay.
And then that actually served up for my because I ran them locally, it's also bringing up a report. So that is over here. It should
so it
be in
runs
this report.
The report on a local host. It fires mm-hmm. up a little mini web server to say, here's what happened. Here's how that whole thing went down. And then, of course, we saw in GitHub Actions, it can go and save those results as test artifacts.
Okay, so I hope I can backtrack here. But in particular, what's really nice when you're running a bunch of these tests, let's say you're debugging, now you've got this trace view. So this trace view actually gives you the ability to watch what's happening, zoom into any location, and see what was happening. And then we have the video so you can also replay the test and very quickly zoom in. So, of course, code by code line debugging, but also this recording, seeing, okay, where did this issue happen? What exactly in the test was it? And then go right into seeing the issues that have been found.
Look at that. It says, I'm just noticing here, it says expect to have text. and I can see that that failed, and it tells you why it failed. And then on the right-hand side, you get all the information and all the logs about exactly how this thing went down. Cool.
It's pretty cool.
I just like stuff like this so much because just like, you know how they talk about 10x developers and we all think it's BS? It's not the person, it's the tool. So like,
it is.
I have like a side thing, right? I have my website and my podcast. It's not part of my job. I don't have a team of 10. I would like to have a team of 10 so I could be a 10x developer. But then when I do stuff like this, I get the multiplier effect. I make some tests. Then I test on Firefox and Edge and Chrome. And then I test on this browser and that browser and that browser. And then I test in containers. And then on these operating systems. Exactly. And then I'm a 10x developer while I sleep.
Which is really nice. So now, I mentioned before, these tests are all in the CI/CD. So if you now go to the .NET podcast, you can go to that web CI/CD, look into the actions. This is one that was run. And right there, you'll actually see the tests as they were run. You can zoom into the details on those tests. And of course, if these fail, which don't worry, I have lots of good failures, you can also go in and zoom into the actual details of the tests, what happened, where different things hit. And now, for every pull request, you can actually catch any regression. So catching defects earlier, that's where we get that 10x developer.
This is so important. We call back to that conversation we had about Visual Studio and how important testing and regressions were. And it's like, wow, they built all this infrastructure, they did all this work, but they pointed out that they do a lot of work with released tools. This is available to you today. Go and test. So whatever application you have at work that you feel some kind of way about, like, you know, I like that app, but I don't really trust that app, write some Playwright tests until you really start to trust and appreciate that application. And then I want to call out something else, because I thought that testing was like about, you know, end-to-end correctness.
Yeah.
And you have strong feelings about that.
I do have some passion here. So absolutely, testing historically has always been around end-to-end correctness. You look at some of the standards even around, oh, here's the standard testing pyramids and things. It has always been in that frame focused on a unit test, functional tests, okay, some integration tests. How are those things working? But in today's world, quality goes so much further than that. Quality is not only about end-to-end correctness, it's also about ensuring that your site is ready for production and it's resilient, because things do go wrong. So with that, we're going to shift a little deeper from Playwright and end-to-end functional testing, and now we're going to start talking about the back end that's supporting that website. And with that, I'm going to go right into my favorite topic, which is Azure load testing. So this service is actually in public preview. We've been out public preview, I think it's been about maybe 10 months. I'm sorry, I don't know that date specifically. But in particular, one of the things with load testing, folks will say, oh, I've got load testing. And there are so many different ways to use load testing service. In particular, a lot of times, way before you're even in production, you want to get ready for production. So you have to sit there and look about how many users am I expecting to have? What's my scale up and scale out? So for fun, I took the immediate .NET podcast, brought it in, started throwing some load tests on it. Well, that helped me discover that, of course, out of the box, it's on an S1, sort of a dev test SKU. And of course, the databases are all on basic, right? They're on a basic tier, because when you first get that, clone that, we don't want you spending money. But you know what? If you're actually starting to think about production, you gotta run some load tests. And with those load tests, you can do, first and foremost, fine tuning, ready for production. But then you can also, with load testing, as you might have seen a little hint before with the CI/CD, is you can actually also check for regressions. So once you've set your baseline metrics, this is how I expect my response time. This is my error rate. This is the latency I expect to see. Then those baseline metrics can actually become part of your CI/CD flow. And so we're going to walk through that today.
And this notion,
and there's something way further.
This notion that you just said about resiliency. Expectations is so important. I noticed that that word that we saw in Playwright world was expect, when I'm used to seeing assert. And then I love that in the load testing world, you said expect as well. And
good
you
point.
See those words interchanged. But here's the deal. You need to assert your expectations. And if you have no expectations and you have no baseline, and then your site by definition cannot be resilient.
you were winging it at that point.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly. I mean, I also want to point out that 20, 25 years ago, when we were doing load testing, we would run around and have other people's laptops say, are you using that machine? Can I install a load agent on it when you're not here? And we would try to create load to make load testing happen. And the advent of the cloud allowed not only our public sites to scale,
yeah.
but the ability to go and enlist as many people as we want.
Exactly. And this is where things get fun. So now my favorite thing to do, it's a little bit of a hobby, is I like to break things. So first and foremost, I told you, we're trying to get ready for production. So for getting ready for production, we're just going to look at our scale out, scale up, start to fine tune. And let me close down a couple things. But you can see this getting started. So writing load test is super easy. First and foremost, one of the prevailing open source solutions for load testing is JMeter. The Azure Load Testing Service allows you to take any existing JMeter tests you have and immediately leverage them. So you can actually upload your JMeter scripts, now run them on the cloud. In addition, if you're just getting started, you can come in here and do a quick start. And the quick start is super easy, very simple wizard. Hey, how many virtual users do I want to do? What site do I want to hit? What page do I want to hit? And then how many engines do I want to actually scale that across? So it gets really fun. Let's say I do 30 virtual users, one engine, I've got 30 users. Throw it across four engines, now I've got 120 users, right? And I can just keep scaling that up. So what I did here on these test runs for my scale up, scale out, is I actually said, okay, I'm gonna start with one engine, 40 users. All right, and I got some okay results. Then I started going the other way and I said, okay, now I'm going to take eight engines, 40 users. Now what happens? And you could see some failures. And then I said, okay, well, let's back that down. Let's see where that fine tune is, and let's see what I'm currently running for. And now what's really nice is I can go into one of these, and I'll first show you. This is the one with the four engines, 40 users. I get both the load test. Okay, what's my error percentage? What's my general request rate throughput? Great, here's my test. I actually get to see some details now on my load test with the engine health of that test. That's okay, that's very interesting. But here's what's so beautiful when you have your system up on Azure is now that's our client side metrics, but I can actually also go in and immediately after even running the test, let's say I've run this client side load test, I can now go in and say, okay, let me add some server side metrics. And I would just go through, click which server-side metrics, what components I want to actually see those metrics, and it will make it immediately available to me. So of that test run, it can go through and actually pick those out.
And super important to point out at the very top there, when you had that list of big bunch of text right here, a little bit farther up, you've got your criteria. That's so important. That criteria is so important. And just a smidge farther, these numbers here, you can decide. Is that a good response time? Depends on your thing. You decide. So failure is up to you.
What are you expecting? And this also helps. And this is a super important thing. We're always trying to balance the trade-off when we're building up, especially our back end, of what we need to pay for. So using load testing to fine-tune, pay for what you need, right? And we're going to talk about spikes and other things in a minute, but you want to pay for what you need, what your expected traffic is, and then have those monitors so you can see the growth of your site, make adjustments. Obviously, with the auto scale capabilities, then you can actually run and change that auto scale even with your load test and see how it reacts. Tons of abilities. And then let's go into the compare. This is one of my favorite parts. So if I go in here, now I want to say, okay, I've gone from one engine, 40 users, eight engines, 40 users, four engines, 40 users. So it's a variety. Now I can actually come in here, select a couple of these.
Pick a good one and a failure.
And I can actually compare them. And all for you is seeing these things side by side. So behind the scenes, really quick, it's bringing up those same metrics. And it's actually showing each test and how they compare. So what's interesting is you'll see the error rates on that eight engine. It got into the test a little ways, and then it started to throttle, right? Because it's like, whoa, 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 too much. This is going past, and that's where those error rates were hitting it.
And you pick that up right away. I assume I don't have to pay for that because once it stops working, it stopped working.
Yeah, that's a great point. So one of the other things with the load testing, and this is both so that you're not paying for load once you've seen the error, but also from a protection. So load tests basically will auto shut off. So let's say you start a load, start hitting, just blitzing a site. After 1 minute, so 60 seconds of 90% error rate, it will auto shut down. In addition, the JMeter autos, I believe it's the listener auto stop. You can also configure that specific within that JMeter script, and it will also customize the, okay, how long do I go and then stop the test? But we do have that hard stop to make sure folks are not actually using the service to DDoS.
So when we all started, I had no test of any kind. I have Playwright tests. Mm-hmm. I have JMeter load testing. But you keep going back to GitHub. I don't understand who's driving the traffic. You have load test, and it says GitHub, run load test. But then you go to Azure, and it says run load test. What's the responsibility of the...
Fantastic. So when I was in Azure, I was really talking about, let's fine-tune our service. Let's explore, figure out that scale up, scale out. So I'm in the portal. I'm using that. Once I've determined what my baseline metrics are, those expectations, then I'm actually going to want to set that so that I can actually do regression detection on every pull request. So let's go into some code really quick. And that actually means I got to close a couple things down, switch over. But if we come here, we've actually added load tests. And with load tests, you can actually both set your baseline metrics. Then you'll come in and you'll actually set up a configuration. Let me hide this. So you'll come in here and you'll say, okay, for YAML. This load test.
You like YAML?
Sometimes.
It's the young person's XML.
Yeah, I am not a young person, but sometimes I like to act like I am. So in this test, this is actually the config.yaml that is getting triggered from, and I'm going to go to it in a second, from the actual GitHub YAML. So the GitHub action YAML calls into this. And this configuration is specific for the load test. It says what load test, what JMeter script, what's the domain I'm hitting. It's hitting the threads per engine. And then it also has the most important part, which is your failure criteria. You can actually go and look on Azure Load Testing Service, look at the failure criteria. It's a really quick search. There is a lot of variables you can add here. I like average response time. There's percentage of errors. There's also, even for response time, you can do like your percentile there. So like your P90. Hey, I want a P90 response time greater than blah, blah, blah. So all of that can be configured. So every time you or your dev team are doing a pull request, that will get checked. So you will immediately find right on that pull request if all of a sudden you have a regression in the system such that your performance takes a dip below that criteria.
Okay, so then I understand that then the config.yaml is the configuration and the failure criteria. It's been checked into GitHub.
Yep.
And then it is not GitHub Actions that is pushing the load. It's GitHub Actions that is telling Azure and Azure Load Testing Service
Thank you.
To then push the load.
Yes.
Okay, now
I understand. So now we come over into the actual web YAML. And so I mentioned, hey, all of this web YAML available, the load tests, we still need to push up to main. Mm-hmm. But in particular, so on the running Playwright, which I mentioned before, you can see where it's actually grabbing the container right here. And in fact, I think I'm supposed to do fancy things
Ooh,
like this.
What?
Yeah, trying to learn. And so it's pulling that package, that Docker container, into the actual pipeline, running it as a containerized job. That's for the Playwright. And then if we scroll down, going down just a little bit, there's all of our tests for Playwright. Here's our load tests. It'll pull the secrets that are needed specifically for Azure out of the GitHub action secret settings. And then it's actually going to run, as I mentioned, that config.yaml for those load tests.
Okay, cool. So my application gets built in this example in GitHub Actions. Mm-hmm. It could be Azure DevOps. Then we pull that container down. Azure GitHub Actions builds it with Playwright, mm-hmm. using the Playwright container.
Yes.
The Playwright having a dedicated container.
Exactly.
I could run that locally. I could run it in any container place. Mm-hmm. And then we have that same stuff that then gets pushed to Azure. And then now, what if though my website's private and I want to test it, but it's not a public URL?
So that's just how you actually configure your load test.
Okay.
So in that one, that is similar kind of to the Playwright. People hide their websites in totally different ways.
I see. So VNets and all the kind of features.
So you can actually hit it against, and in fact, it was released just in August. The load testing does private endpoints.
Oh, cool.
But you can also do all of the same things. You know, some people do private endpoints for keeping things secret. Sometimes they wrap it around auth, you know, hidden auth that only internal folks can access. So whichever way you want, Azure load testing can do it.
Very cool. So then when I leave today, I'm going to have testing.
Yeah.
Of all kinds.
And we will get those load tests up. That's the one thing. We have not pushed that to main, but we will get that there.
That's cool. Is this the sum total of testing? Is testing just Playwright plus load testing?
No, this is where we get really fun. So now, I mentioned fine-tuning before production. I mentioned regression detection. Now, this is the world that I really love, which is breaking it on purpose. Now, you want to break things. This is continuous validation. When you want to break things, you want to do it on purpose, ideally in a staging environment, some kind of pre-production. But also in some cases, you might find, okay, here's where I'm going to actually test this to see not just what happens when I spike with load, but we're actually testing whether our monitors are working. Are our alerts working? Right? Testing is no longer about correctness. Testing is whether or not you're going to find out things have gone wrong, because things do go wrong, before your customer finds out that those things have gone wrong.
Okay, what is this thing that breaks it on purpose called?
Okay, so we have multiple things. We can test spiking load, and then we can also test with Chaos Studio.
Chaos Studio, not Mischief Studio.
Chaos Studio. So you can find the Chaos Studio inside of Azure. Couple of things I'm going to walk through. So with Chaos Studio, there is a huge fault library available. The areas that Chaos Studio is focused on first and foremost is helping you to actually go into your infrastructure. So your AKS, your VMs, your VMSS, your network, and really target faults there. Doing things like delaying the network. All of these are faults that you can create with Chaos Studio on purpose to see how things react. These are exercises that we're starting to put into the bucket of continuous validation. So you've heard continuous integration, you've heard continuous deployment, but there's also continuous validation. And these, depending on the range of different faults you might introduce, would literally set what schedule you'd run these on. So let me show you a couple of things, some that I've already created.
Okay.
And I'll also show, in first and foremost, one of the gotchas. And this is not a gotcha on purpose, it's a gotcha for permissions. So right now, I create an experiment, DNS, right? A DNS outage. I want to exercise DNS outage because, you know, the joke is, it's always DNS, right? So in this DNS outage, I've gone in and actually, let me go back to just creating an experiment.
It's always DNS was a famous quote from Abraham Lincoln.
It is, isn't it? Yeah, true story.
He said that. So chaos engineering is literally subjecting your site to chaos. And by we mean chaos is like, hey, what's that cable do, yank? Right? It's the cloud version of, oops, I tripped over that wire. And you're making experiments to, and they say all these words. I love picking specific words. It's not Mischief Studio. It's not Chicanery Studio. It's Chaos Studio. It's mess up your app on purpose. We're having expectations and we're having experiments. She's making an experiment to say, I think my app is going to not like the database being dropped. Let's see.
Let's see what happens.
Let's turn off DNS. It'll be fine.
And here's what gets really interesting with chaos. It's not just one thing, right? A lot of times it's like, well, I need to do one step and then another thing happens, right? Because the complexity of what we are building, right, it's a combination of a lot of things. So with Chaos Studio, we've actually got both steps and branches that you can set. You can then sort of delay action, let something run to sort of queue up. Okay, I'm just going to start a network delay. Then I'm going to add another fault. In the faults right here, you go very simple test, add a fault. It's going to show me, we'll select a fault. And now you can see all of the faults already available for you.
It'll process.
So guess what we're going to be doing at build?
Oh, yeah.
Cosmos DB failover. Yes, can we get an applause for that one? Let's go in there and break that thing, right? Let's go in and disconnect our network without having people in our data center, right? You can't do that with Azure, but let's go and actually set up these chaos experiments. Any of these, you can now go in, create right. these faults. Now, couple of things. This is the gotcha. I told you I had a gotcha. So we don't want people just doing this, right? I mean, wait a minute.
Well, I was thinking about ways I could write chaos to mess up your site.
Exactly.
And then it's like a red versus blue thing.
Ah. So the deal is you're actually going to say, okay, within that fault, I'm going to have a target. What am I doing that actual target
it's
against?
It's permissive.
Yes. And so in this particular experiment, I've actually said, okay, I'm going to go after the NSG, right?
The Network Security Group.
Thank you. I am really TLA'd.
That's all good. We got about 4 minutes.
Okay, so really quick. So here's my network security group. Now, if I go and want to break that network security group, I don't want anybody able to do that. So if you're setting up an experiment, and this is a gotcha, we have it all over the documents, but I still want to walk everyone through it, is right here, I actually have to go into the access control. I'm going to go in here and I'm going to add a role assignment. So I'm actually going to say, yeah, I actually want you to be able to do this. Big 1080, you've got to scroll way down here. So I go to the network contributor in this particular case.
So each thing that the Chaos Studio could mess up, you have to give it explicit permission. Make sure that you're not causing chaos in production, but you're causing chaos maybe in staging.
Yes.
And that you know that you intend to do this. And it is all about intentionality.
Yes. And then in here, you're going to say manage identity. And now I've said select members. I'll go in here and I have, you can see, oh, chaos experiment. Okay. Yes.
Got it.
That's the one I'm going to set permission on so that I can actually go in and attack that network security group.
Cool. And then at this point, we know it's going to do something. And this is really important. If the network goes down, what do you want your app to do? You might say, well, so what? They made it break.
Yep.
Well, maybe you use browser local storage. Maybe you pop a dialog box up. Maybe you let them know, we'll be back in a second. What happens when it goes bad? You need to decide and then intentionally cause it, and then you can actually test. Oh, this is what happens when the product catalog works, but the shopping cart doesn't, or whatever. This is about those experiments that you could never run before.
Okay, so now we're going to toggle through a couple things really quick. Here's that network security group, right? Everything's good. My VNet says inbound is okay. Let's go over to that experiment. Let's see if I can't take this one and start it.
So now it warns you. It literally just said you're about to cause some chaos that will cause a problem in your system. Okay.
So it's pre-processing. Now I'm going to go over into this network security group. I'm going to come back to that same view, hide the essentials. We're just going to give a little bit of time because I think I have a 5-second queue up.
You know, I don't really appreciate the glee that you have about causing chaos.
I know.
There was a video game I used to play on Xbox called Just Cause. He would run around and he would like blow things up and then it would go chaos points, you know. And I feel like you're getting chaos points as we run around and destroy the podcast.
There's a little bit. Now, it has to be planned, though. You can't just do it. You have to set the permissions.
Okay.
So things like working with your team to set up monthly. Hey, monthly, we're going to do this drill. Monthly, we're going to do this drill.
So it's like chaos Tuesdays. It's not.
There we have it.
Everyday chaos.
Exactly.
Oh, and you just. Did you just
there
break
it is. Okay. Yeah. So now all inbound traffic broken. That is not going to work. What is beautiful about being able to use this chaos, again, I want to remind folks, it's not, oh, let's just see what happens. Ideally, right then and there, you're checking on alerts, your monitors, all of those things that, hey, did my devs get notified? How quickly did they get there? You know, what is our response time? How are we dealing with incidents and those kinds of things? So
that. Let's see if we got, we have 90 seconds. Let's see if we got a couple questions here in 90 seconds. Molly, let's just run through that real quick. Scroll.
I saw a lot of questions coming through.
There are a bunch of questions.
So we're going to go back.
We only have a minute to do that, which is our bad, and I'm putting pressure on our friends running the thing here. I saw someone say, we lost our questions. I do see that a lot of people have not heard of Playwright, so that makes me happy that people are doing that. Well, we will be able to answer questions a little bit later. We are going to step out there to the left and spend a little bit of time. I want to let you know what's coming up next. We've got Catherine and Mark doing production debugging in Azure, and we've got David Lee and Dustin talking about game development in C++. And what's our takeaway? Make tests.
So make tests, have fun with tests. There is a lot of power that's coming your way. Do know that we want to learn from you. We know that every dev team is different. So do know that we're looking to make sure that we can provide you testing tools that you can integrate where you need it, help you shift left, catch them as soon as possible. Thank you all so much. My name is Jen Perret, and I look forward to talking to you about quality going forward. Thanks, everyone.
Big hand for Jen Perret.